What's up, guys? Cream here. If you want more free content from myself, GaryW, and the rest of the Get Down DJ group, we invite you to join our free Get Down University Slack community. We post content daily, like topical coaching videos, blog posts, curated playlists, exclusive bootlegs, and so much more. It's a dope community of DJs who want to help each other learn more and grow our DJ businesses. If you'd like to join, click the link in the show notes or hit us up on Instagram at GetDownDJGroup. Do you want to grow your DJ business and turn your passion for DJing into a profitable profession? GetDown University Masterclass has already helped our members book more gigs and lock down residencies even during a pandemic. Our next masterclass starts soon, and we're looking for new members who are ready to invest in themselves. Our 8-week course offers 8 lessons with over 90 videos, templates, and PDF documents, along with weekly group coaching calls with myself, GaryW, and Brandon Barris, our marketing director. We want to help teach you what it takes to build a real DJ business. The best part is you can get all of this content, knowledge, and experience for the average price of 1 to 2 DJ gigs. Click the link in the show notes for more information on Get Down University Masterclass and become part of the GDU team. Grow your business, book more gigs, and turn your passion into a profession. What's up, guys? Cream here. This episode, we have 4AM DJ and New York City's own Rick Wondra on the show. Rick's not only a dope DJ, but a producer, graphic designer, photographer, and bourbon collector. Rick's definitely one of our favorite DJs and has one of the most clean, well-thought-out brands of anyone. This episode, we talk NYC quarantine, what goes into the Rick Wondra brand, and some advice for DJs looking to grow their businesses even during this time. Let's get into this episode of The Get Down with Rick Wondra. What's up, guys? Welcome to the 17th episode of The Get Down. My name is Cream.
GaryW here. What up, guys?
We have a very special guest this episode. My man, Rick Wondra. What's up, Rick?
What's up, guys? What's going on?
Nothing, man. Happy to have you.
We're real excited to have you on. Cream and I definitely admire a lot of your work, you know, as far as branding, which we'll get into, and obviously your music. So, We've also worked with some of the same people, so this is going to be a fun conversation for sure.
Yes, for sure. Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me on.
Definitely. So first thing I want to talk about, I mean, you're living and working kind of in what I would call the epicenter of quarantine. You're in Midtown Manhattan, and you've kind of seen from start to now what's gone on, and we just want to like hear a little bit about it, living through it and being there, because we see it, but like I pop into the city here and there. I'm not living there, you know?
Yeah. So it was kind of really, it happened really fast and it was really weird at the beginning. And now it seems like normal, which is scary in its own way. Right before like the whole lockdown happened, we were actually playing a takeover in Boston, and we landed and we heard like a rumor, like, oh, hand sanitizer sold out because of like some China shit. Like literally like that's all it was. And I was like, we took like an Uber back to the city. And I was like, yo, there's no way hand sanitizer is sold out. Like, it's literally, like, everybody sells hand sanitizer. Yeah. And me and Chachi went to, like, 5 places on the way home from Penn Station. We literally live, like 4 blocks from Penn Station. And it was gone. And I was like, that's so awkward. I got, like, 1 bottle of hand sanitizer, played brunch that Sunday. And I was, like, joking around. Like, everyone went to, like, give me a high five. Like, oh, here you go, like, whatever. And then that was Sunday. There was a rumor on Wednesday about like, you know, like stuff was getting crazier and crazier. I played Bounce that Friday and 10 people showed up. And normally Bounce is like sold out, wall to wall crazy.
Yeah.
I was supposed to be at Lavo that Saturday and something else, and everything got canceled. And at the same time, my girl and I were like, oh, like, let's see what's going on. We looked on YouTube and like Wuhan, China, what it looked like. And we're like, and we were both like, there's no way New York City is going to end up like that. It's impossible. You can't do that. Like, and literally a week later, nobody was on the streets. You could have, we could have sat and had this conversation with 3 chairs in the middle of 7th Avenue and just like this. And would have been like, it was like some kind of like I Am Legend. It was the strangest thing. And like seeing it, you know, if like you got like, well, obviously you can't see, but like if I look out my window, I literally see like 7th Avenue, one of like the busiest streets in one of the busiest cities. And to see it to go from like packed to complete ghost town overnight was just the strangest, strangest, eeriest thing.
The few times that I had in, that I was in the city, like early on, what I noticed most was like, I could hear the wind and I could hear birds. And I was like, what the hell? This is so weird.
it was really strange. At one point, I remember like, I was like, do you hear that? And my girl was like, what? It was like 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Like, should have been like rush hour, like on a Friday. Like for a while there, like all the days like kind of blurred together because we were all like, you know, home, lockdown. And it was like 5 o'clock on a Friday and it was nothing. Like literally like not one sound. And I was like, this is the creepiest thing ever.
We threw our DJ meetup right as this started, and we got from Secaucus onto the east side of the city. We were at Splice Studios, and we got there in 20 minutes. And that's when we knew something was wrong. Like really wrong. And then I, at the meetup, the same thing, like hand sanitizer was like premium. Yeah. Everybody was sanitizing up. We had 100 people there and it was probably the stupidest thing we had ever done, but it was planned for like 3 months out. We're like, we were caught in the middle of that. Do you cancel or do you not? And then it was wild to, like I said, go into the city and see that. And then I traveled back to Florida the next day and I was like, New York City was crazy. And nobody down here believed anything.
Yeah,
I was
it was so strange to literally like see, like watch a YouTube video about like how one of the busiest cities in China locked down. And then within 2 weeks, that was New York City. And I was like, this is crazy. And then, you know, 3 months felt like that. And then next thing you know, everything's getting boarded up and there's riots and there's this and there's that. It was a lot of stuff to experience in the last couple of months.
Right. And that's just living there. That's not even talking about the nightlife scene and what's going on with that. So you've been working a little bit over the summer, but most of your parties and stuff you've been doing has been outside of Manhattan, right?
Yeah. There's really Manhattan right now, nightlife wise is at like a standstill because it was hit so hard so early on. It's literally like the last place to like really open back up fully. I mean, take away the politics. Like it's a very dense city and it's very hard to, you know, control certain things. So right now, even right now, there's really not any legal DJing going on as far as, you know, like the public knows. There's outdoor dining, which they just extended all year round. You know, there's going to be heaters and stuff like that. And I think starting next week, it's 25% capacity or a 50-person cap, whichever comes first. Hopefully by November, it's 50%. And yeah, I mean, most of the nightlife, you know, and most of the DJs I've talked to, it's either like stuff in, you know, Long Island City, Queens. Astoria became a hot spot for like a week and then they shut that down, you know. Jersey stuff, you know, the shore, which I'm surprised they don't extend some of the shore places into the fall a little bit more.
I think they are trying, they're still having nightlife and having DJs and stuff, but I just think most people, you're only dealing with locals now because most people were heading south from up in this area down to their houses, and their houses end Labor Day, so it's a lot harder to get down there to go party if you don't live around there, you know?
Right. Especially now the traffic is back.
Yeah.
it's like everything's back except the hospitality and DJ side of life, which is.
Yeah. You know. And it's crazy seeing shit shut down, like major spots that are closing. And it's like, well, when's the pain going to stop? Because we're going to get to the point where we're going to get back to 100% and we're going to have to like recreate our nightlife scenes. That's how I look at it.
Yeah. So I've had a lot of talks with a lot of people about this stuff, and a lot of stuff I predicted up until now, and my predictions kind of ended, but up until now, my predictions for how the summer was going to go and how, you know, budgets were going to be and stuff like that have pretty much been on the money. And I've had talks with like some older generations of promoters and DJs and some of the young kids and some of the current people that hold a lot of weight in the industry and stuff like that. And there's going to be a positive side. It's going to suck for the next 6 months, the next year. The vaccines, the vaccine, everybody thinks is going to be a cure-all. I don't know. I don't think it's necessarily going to save or change nightlife. And it's not like, this isn't like conspiracy talk. It's just like, after a certain amount of time, people get programmed to be a certain way. Even the most craziest, most outgoing party people have been locked down for months and months and months. They're going to feel weird going back to clubs. And that's going to take some time to wear off. But on the positive things, this can force a change and force something better. I don't think we'll ever go back to the way things were. There's not going to be a, you know, up and down on a Tuesday and catch on a Wednesday and, you know, oak on a Sunday type thing, you know, as far as like New York City nightlife. But that doesn't mean that what will come next won't be better. Like if you look at the history and like big events and big changes force evolution sometimes in a good way. Like back in the day, you had the big clubs like Sound Factory and Exit and Roxy, these clubs, these mega clubs in New York City that got replaced with lounges. And then, you know, the economy changes. There was a recession. It was September 11th. All these things forced different changes. And people are like, oh, nightlife isn't the same because of, you know, Webster Hall and Potch is not there. Well, yeah. But the party got shifted and is in Brooklyn at a 5,000 person venue called Brooklyn Mirage. And the scene in Brooklyn now is amazing. So just because you're not in Manhattan partying, that doesn't mean the parties over there are even better. You know, like for years, the party was in the Hamptons in Long Island. And, you know, things changed and towns got pissed off and economies changed and things like that. But then a new and even better scene evolved and came up in Montauk. You know, so I don't know what the next thing is going to be. I've been around in New York City nightlife for a long time. And I know it never dies. It evolves. You know, there was a time when where Marquee is on 27th Street, there was 20 venues on one block. It was clubbing.
You had everything.
And then it's like, this is going to last forever. It's going to last forever. It's going to be amazing. And then it died. But nightlife didn't die. It moved on to meatpacking. And there was 20 clubs in meatpacking. And it was rocking. You know, and people forget about 27th Street and they only know about meatpacking. And then meatpacking starts dying, but then stuff pops up in the Lower East Side and in Brooklyn and in Jersey. So just because like what was normal last year doesn't mean that probably isn't going to ever be there again. But a year from now, we might be like, yo, I can't believe this is awesome where we're at, whatever it is. Yeah. I don't know what it is, but I know it there definitely will be something and it might be bigger and better than ever, you know, because this might, you know, rents are going to go down. Things are going to change. This might give way for new independent venues that aren't controlled by a corporate conglomerate that owns a ton of venues, that sets low DJ prices, that sets all these different things. There might be, you know, more independently operated venues that care about specific kinds of music or GA crowds or whatever it is a year or two from now.
That's realistically what changed, right, from the early 2000s to the mid 2000s, was that you did have these independently, I mean, outside of the major nightclub shift that Giuliani got rid of. The major change was that you went from these individually, like the Peter Gation had one or two spots, and then it went on to having people like, you know, M Group having a bunch of spots. You know, in when lounges became popular. So you're right. And especially in New York City, things change on a dime, right? I feel like the only thing that really hasn't changed in New York City was, listen, Tuesday night was always a dope night to go out. And like outside of that, like, cause you know, Friday and Saturday was Bridge and Tunnel. But, you know, outside of that, it's constantly changing. And this is, like you said, going to force a change, whether it be across the river, whether it be out to Long Island, whatever it might be.
I don't know what it is,
I think people in general are just scared of change. And it sucks right now. We're not making money. People aren't going out, whatever. But people are scared of change and they're scared. And like you said, even though something's changing, it doesn't mean that it's going to go away forever. And I think all this change creates a lot of opportunity. So whether that opportunity is for DJs or promoters to buy their own places, whether it's a young DJ to step up and take the reins of a spot that maybe he would have never had an opportunity to play at, or whether it's changing locations, like you said, like, I just think that it creates a ton of opportunity. And I think that's something positive that we can all look forward to. We don't know what it is. And yeah, it might be a little scary, but maybe the music's going to change. Maybe like the style of venue is going to change. Hopefully the pricing eventually comes back up to a higher number. Yeah. But I think I agree with you. I think we all have to be just a little patient, deal with what we have to deal with now, go play the gigs that might not be what we want them to be. And eventually, you know, the people that are putting in work and the people that are hustling and putting out music and putting out content are going to be the people that make it through this and are working those dope new spots and parties.
I think you just touched on like a really important thing. It's like, now's the opportunity for like, if you were pigeonholed in one style of DJing, or you were like, you know, you didn't really have a chance to be your own, create your own identity. Well, now you can, whether it's through your live streams or your branding or, you know, photo shoots or producing music or whatever. You have so much time that you can take advantage of now to create a name for yourself and stay relevant, or be even more relevant, or create even a bigger brand, or network with even more people, so that when the time comes, you're like, you're right there, ready to go, you know, instead of like the people like, oh, I'm just going to sit back and wait for things to go back the way they were. Well, cool. But then that person that opened up for you 6 months ago, you might be opening up for them, because they worked five times harder than you, and they have 5,000 people on Twitch, and their Instagram jumped, you know, 10,000 people, and they got a popping podcast or whatever it is, you know?
I think that's one of the reasons why we really wanted to talk to you, because there are a lot of guys that are at your level that are kind of just sitting back like, well, I'll start working when the money comes back and I'll go do my thing. But I think what is really great about you, and I think what really sets you apart, is that you haven't just sat back. You've maybe even like doubled down on the stuff that you're putting out. So like around the Rick Wonder brand, like how was it created, and what are some of the things that are really important to you?
It's kind of an evolving thing. I can't like put my finger on exactly like what the specific theme is, other than I like to create, and I like to create what I think is dope, whether that's in the form of music or videography or photography or merch or whatever it is. I like to look at each stream and each thing as like an opportunity to create something cool, you know, whether it's, and I think that's just it's really hard to explain, because it's just a consistency in a brand that it's just a consistent like vibe, I guess, what it is, you know.
Well, it speaks to who you are and what you like, and you don't care about what other people like as much as, I think this is dope, I want to do stuff like this, and this is what I want to project out into the world.
Well, like a while ago, I realized, like, you know, all of us DJs, we want to please everybody, and open format DJs, our main goal is to make everybody happy. But sometimes by trying to make everybody happy, you really make nobody happy. So I've been trying to shift my brand to just be a little bit more condensed, a little bit more niche. I'm starting to realize that instead of trying to make 100,000 people follow you and be like, yeah, he's whatever, I'd rather have 5,000 people be like, yo, I really messed with this dude. He's awesome. You know, sometimes, you know, going a little more specific on your brand, whether it's a little bit more like, you know, I'm trying to push my brand a little more of like a housier direction, a little more like late night, you know, a little bit more downtown New York City vibe, I guess, aesthetic or whatever it is. It might not please everybody, but the people that find me or hear my music or connect with me will really connect and hopefully be like a fan for life or a friend for life or a supporter for life, versus like someone that heard me play the baby song like everybody else. I'm like, yeah, he was all
right. Right.
I heard the same 100 songs I was here, you know?
That's definitely something that we've been preaching a little bit more to people in our core, in our GDU course, is that, you know, people that are coming up and just learning the ropes of branding and whatnot is, you know, find your ride or dies, like you're saying. And, you know, those people are going to come out and support you week after week, no matter what. It's nice to have 100,000 followers on Instagram and that, you know, it looks all beautiful and everything, but it's better to have 50 people that are going to come out constantly and support you and put money behind the bar, which is going to get you more gigs.
Yeah, exactly. Right? Those 50 people, like, you know, all they do is tell five of their friends, like, yo, I really think this dude's awesome. You should check him out, you know? And hopefully that, you know, expands into a much more targeted, much more genuine audience.
That's definitely the best way to grow. Might not be the fastest, but you're growing the strongest base of followers. If you're converting those 50 people, let's say, to your being a fan of you. And then, like you said, the word of mouth carries more weight than anyone else. or than anything else, because when I used to go out, I'd be like, yo, I want to go see Toro. I think Toro is such a dope DJ. And I would make all my friends go see Toro wherever he was at on that Friday or Saturday, because I thought he was dope and I was always really connected to the music. He is dope.
He's awesome.
Yeah, he's great. But like, I think that's really important. And I think a lot of the regulars that I have at some of my residencies have become my friends and have become such a great asset to have in my corner, just promoting and supporting the things that I do. So I love that. And I think if we looked at it like, grow those rabid fans rather than grow this huge general fan base.
Right.
It makes such a bigger difference.
Pick what you believe in and what you like. And, you know, like I try to like, not preach, but I try to like promote positivity. And, you know, like, I don't really try to like hate on stuff. I try to like, you know, I'd rather uplift people. And I, you know, I just try to run like a real clean brand. I try to stay away from controversies. I try to, you know, be artistic and as creative as I possibly can, whether it's, you know, with my photos or my recap videos or whatever it is. That's what I like to push towards. And hopefully, you know, like people vibe with that.
Yeah.
You know, like, I think one thing every DJ has to do from time to time is check your ego and realize you're not going to be for everybody. Not everyone's going to like you, and you're not going to be able to please everybody, you know, to be you, and the people that fuck with that will stick around or find you or hear about you one way or another.
Yeah. And having all this time for the last 6 months to really hone in on what you want to be and what you want to do and what you want to put out into the world. Like, if you haven't been doing that, you're missing a huge opportunity. So
yeah,
I just feel like this gave us a minute to like take a step back from DJing, you know, like 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 gigs in a week and be able to focus on some of the other stuff and take a step back and be like, well, I wasn't really enjoying playing those 5 open format parties in a row that like, yeah, they paid me, but like, it wasn't that fun to me.
Well, yeah.
Or whatever.
That's another thing. It's like, especially as like, you know, open format heavy DJs, we're programmed to be like, all right, new the baby, gotta play it. New Roddy Ricch, yeah, gotta play it. 2 weeks into my quarantine, or 2 weeks into live streaming during the quarantine. Sorry, because I didn't really live stream at the beginning, but 2 weeks to live streaming, I played that. I'm like, do I actually like this? Like, there's no manager being like, yo, this guy just popped money.
Yeah,
you gotta play this song right now. I made a decision. I was like, I really don't want to listen to hip hop like anymore ever. Like, if this parties and places, like some places I enjoy playing and I like getting into it, but like, if I'm gonna play sets and I'll just represent me, that I don't have to like be forced to play something, I'm just gonna do what I like versus what I have to do. And I think that's one of the biggest struggles for a lot of open format DJs, is trying to find your identity when we're supposed to cast such a wide net and please so many different people. Being like, now's the opportunity to be like, yo, I really like Jersey Club. Well, start producing Jersey Club and, you know, find Jersey Club fans and make some Jersey Club edits and
yeah,
that, or trap, or maybe you do like the babies. You're like, whatever. I can use a reference, but I'm not hating. I'm just saying like in general. Like,
nah, we know what you mean. Yeah. we've talked extensively about new hip hop.
Yeah. Oh, I went on Rap Caviar the other day. Bruh.
I listened to it too, just because I'm like, I have to go listen to Rap Caviar and just see like what's being put out. And like, there's gotta be like 10 songs that I'm into, but like, there's just not.
Yeah. Now like the couple of events that I played and someone's like, you gotta play this new song. I'm like, no, I don't. And they're like, why? I'm like, cause I survived the pandemic and I'm playing music. I'm like,
yeah,
you can go to the car, listen to that song on your Spotify. I'm going to teach you about good music right now. You know, I mean,
I think that's one thing that super surprised me was your pivot. Not your pivot, because I was listening to a lot of your mixes that you put out prior to the pandemic and they were, you know, house heavy. But being a New York City DJ, you kind of get labeled hip hop mm-hmm. first, in my opinion. So the amount of versatility that you have and the stuff that you would post in your stories, there was one track that comes to mind in particular for me was The Bleachers Don't Take the Money, which is like a crazy just indie track.
Yeah,
you know, and I'm like, I can't even believe that that's something that like you would throw into a set, but it just shows just like your wide range of versatility and the things that you're into and what you're looking to play or not play.
Yeah, so matter. Well, Bleachers honestly is one of my favorite artists like all time, like ever. Like I've like
that video is ridiculous.
I love like stuff like that. I've always been into. I've actually I know a lot of New York City DJs get labeled hip hop first. I actually started out as I was house DJ. I started playing hip hop like halfway through my career. I played like the parties back in the day in New York City. There was, I'm sure you guys remember, there was like doors open at 4 a.m. parties and like real after hours type stuff. I played a lot of those in the beginning. I played a lot of like the side room, like house heavy after hours stuff where I'd go to like, I played a night at Pacha. It was Clash of the Titans. Junior Vasquez and Jonathan Peters were on the main floor. V-Tone and I played the basement from 12 to 12, hour for hour, from 12 at night until 12 in the afternoon the next day. Like that's the type of stuff I started on. And then as time went on, I could realize I could play, you know, two nights a week as a house DJ, or I can play like five nights a week as an open format DJ, and slowly made the transition around the time of like the bottle popping lounges, like really took over. I linked with promoters that were like, yo, we'll put you on. First, they would put me on because they wanted the house crowd to come to their parties. So I would play early. I'd play like, you know, like from open at 11 to like 12:30, and then big band or whatever hip hop DJ would go on. And then one night, I forget, I on Long Island, I always played like a mix of everything. But one night it was, I forget what club it was, the big band or finesse or whoever supposed to be, didn't show up or got in a car accident, not a car accident, like had car trouble, couldn't make there, whatever it was. And I was like, I think I could play this. And I played the whole night open format. And he's like, oh, you keep doing that, I'll book you every night. And I was like, all right. So that's when the switch happened. So that's why, like, I think I've always been drawn back to house and had such appreciation of like house and these other genres, where most open format DJs come from a hip hop background and learn to play everything. I came from a house background playing music and listening to rock music, and then adapted into a hip hop open format DJ. There was a time when if you played a hip hop song in my car, I'd tell you to get out. I'd be like, just get up. This doesn't get played. It was like, you know, it was Green Day and, you know, stuff like that. So
when did you link with 4AM and Chachi? Or was that
always? Chachi's been one of my best friends for like a long time. I actually opened for him when I was 15 at a teen night in Long Island. That's how long we've known each other. I'm 35, so that's got to have been a while ago. and then we reconnected on 27th Street at like Home and Guest House. We ran into each other, and we were both like involved in Mood Swing, which is a big agency back in the day. And then when he left, he went to Stadium Red, which was repping the Chainsmokers at the time. And I had just gotten rid of my office. It was like we linked up and kind of had each other back for years. And then when he went to 4AM, it kind of just made sense for me to make the jump there. And I don't even know how many years ago that was now, five, something like that. But yeah, we've been having each other's back and linked for a while. Him, PS1, the whole crew.
I think that's really, like, to me, it's really important you said that you link with somebody, you've had each other's back, because Gary and I have done the same thing. And when we first linked and started helping each other, and just like looking out for each other in the industry, like both of us started growing twice as quickly as we were prior to that. And I think for a long time in New York and New Jersey, everyone was really like out for themselves and didn't care about helping other people. And I feel like the aspect of like having someone around that has your back and you have theirs and helping each other grow is the easiest way to success. And I don't know, what do you think about that? I mean, you kind of lived it too, so.
It is. It's so important. I feel like you're right. So many, the West Coast has it down, and the East Coast should learn and do that more. It's like the camaraderie makes you stronger. Like I told a lot of people, I like what you guys do with like the meetups and the university and stuff like that. Like you're helping the next generation. You're helping bring DJs together. Just like on, you know, like what I was saying with the West Coast guys do with the HMC meetups and conferences and stuff. I think it's important. And like, you know, having each other's back, whether it's like, you know, meeting up and trading music or, you know, edits, or like if I have a gig and I get double booked, I'd rather give it to a homie that I trust that can play the same style as me and that won't try to undercut me and steal my residency for next week, rather than just be like, you know, fill in for me, do a great job, and we keep it with us. You know, and we can, you know, whether it's an agency member or just a friend, it's like, yo, I got two bookings this Friday. Can you do this one for me? I know you'll rock it. you know.
Right. And then you're doubling your network because it's not only your own network, it's yours and the other person's network, which I think is really, really valuable too, because in this world, your network is the most important thing that you can build and create or whatever. So
I think like, you know, by helping each other, you gain so much more than by hating on each other and just being like the lone, you know, the lone wolf out for yourself, you know?
Yep. That's what Get Down is. Like, we're trying to bring DJs together to help each other, help the younger guys not make the mistakes that we made, and also help the market as a whole. Because if the younger guys know to not go play for $150 for 4 hours, like, it helps everybody, you know? So if we could help younger guys out and also help them grow and get their own bookings, mm-hmm. that undercutting shit can get cut out of the market, and you could create a higher base price for any DJ gig, you know?
You know, and that's one thing I've always, like, I've admired, and I really, like, I pay attention. I've messaged you from time to time, like, you're like, I like what you guys do and stuff, because I think it's important, and it's something that lacks, especially, like, in our industry of, like, you know, like, you think about it, like the tattoo industry, like, before you become an artist, you got to become an apprentice. You learn the ways, you learn the traditions, you learn how to do stuff. And DJing, a lot of that doesn't happen. You know, like, DJs don't really take another one under their wing. If they do, it's like one person. They never want to be as big as them. They never want a headline like them. They'll never be like, yo, let's go back to back. You know, and that's something that's important. It's like, you know, you look out for the younger guys. A, it'll make you last longer. And B, it will keep this industry evolving and growing in a positive way instead of an undercut thing. You know, it's these newer guys, when they open the room and they play every banger known to mankind, or they're scratching all the time or yelling, sometimes because they don't know and they weren't taught the right way. They have the best intentions and potential and skills. Just nobody told them, hey, you can play stuff from 8 years ago and still rock it and set up this way. You know, I think it's important. It's important to, you know, groom.
I think with the advent of social media, I think it's really made it easier for DJs to connect in more of a positive mm-hmm. way, where, you know, I think back in the day, approaching a DJ booth as a DJ, it was a little mm-hmm. intimidating, right? Like, especially because I remember, like, one night I went out to go see Big Ben. Me and my boy went to go see Big Ben at Sweet 16. This is how long ago that was. Yeah. And, like, he was raw. I mean, not that you can go see him at the time and say what's up, because he was ripping a record, an actual vinyl, every 45 seconds, which was incredible. But, like, you know, we looked at each other and we're like, well, we're not going to approach this guy. There's not a shot that, like, we're going to stay to the end of the set and like go up to him. Like, he was super dope, whatever. But I feel like with social media, you have that disconnect where you can DM somebody, as long as you do it the right way, you know, where you're not like dick riding or anything, but, like, you know, and do it in a professional manner. You know, that can open that door for you, you know? So I think that's the difference between, like, old school mentality versus new school.
Yeah, 100%. I think that's one, like, that's people always like say, talk about how social media is like fucked everything up in a way. Can we curse on you? I don't even know if we can curse.
Yeah. You're good.
like social media is, like, you know, destroying society and all that crap like that, but there's so many positives. And that's one example. Like, I reach out to artists way bigger than me all the time. Like, yo, I'm a big fan of your stuff. Like, you're awesome. If I make something you like, can I send it to you, please? Like, you couldn't do that. So, like, you know, you couldn't do that before this. That's such a, you know, it's a good thing to bring up. It's a positive thing you can do now. You can just link up. You can have group chats with, you know, your DJ community, you know, or a thread or whatever it is, and be able to link and help each other. And it's a good thing.
Gary and I were just talking about how, like, we post something for Get Down, let's say, and there's, like, 20 guys who are, like, engaged and liking and commenting, and, like, everybody kind of helps each other out. Obviously the social media thing is pretty important and the engagement's really important. So the positivity is key. And I love that you mentioned that earlier. And I think if more people stayed positive and use social media for positive outlet instead of hating or fighting about politics or whatever else, like, we'd be better off. But just keeping it more in the DJ world, like, yeah, I'll make an edit and I'll, if it's whoever it is, it could be Armin van Buuren. I'll be like, hey man, big fan. Maybe that's not a good example, but, like, some of the, like, Golowski, someone I've messaged, be like, yo, I made this track. I'm a big fan of your stuff. Do you mind if I send it to you? And I send it to him, and then he's playing it at festivals. Like,
yeah.
It just takes a little bit of effort. All you have to do is reach out and say what's up and be cool and not be, you know, a dick about it. And people are going to answer you.
Well, everyone, everyone's a person, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we're all going through the same shit right now. So
literally everyone's going through the same shit right now. There's no exceptions.
So I guess the next thing I want to ask you about is your original music, because I feel like you've been going a lot harder on that stuff. And I've been playing the Bingo Players remix. I think that one is real dope.
Thanks.
And yeah, you kind of used to make more of like that trappy pop vocal, and now you're kind of into more of a, I feel like what you like, that like futury bassy sound.
Yeah.
What's up with original music? Like, what's the vision there? What are you working on?
So I started an alias that I'm letting out soon too, which is for like real, like more like underground, more tech house type stuff that I've been focusing on a lot. But nice. For like the trap stuff, it was fun for a while. Like all the remixes D-Star and I did and stuff like that. It was fun. It's just, like I said, I really like house music, and I feel like house, especially with open format, especially in like the more commercial world, is having this like awesome moment where it's this hip hop is getting so bad. At the same time, house is getting so good, like, and not like the EDM, you know, hard, aggressive stuff, but like real like dance and house music, you know, like with like the Head and Heart song and all the Joel Corey stuff and James Hype remixes and all stuff like that, that are more commercial friendly. It's in such a place where it's like, it's fun to produce. I enjoy making it. It's more relevant to how I curate my sets, that that's just really like quarantine. I was like, you know what? That's what I'm going to work on like crazy. And I'd be like, I watched like at least one YouTube tutorial a day. You know, I open up Ableton for a couple hours every day, you know, just work on different. So I have like six tracks done. One's coming out in December. A couple of them are collabs. Which I really didn't collaborate a lot of people outside of like D-Star back in the day, where now I've been reaching out to artists, like how, what we're just talking about. And it's like, yo, I think you can make this track better than where I got it to be. So you want to, like, I'll hand it off to you if you're down. And I've reached out to a couple different artists where it's like, you know, pass the baton kind of thing, because I can only get it so far. You know, so there's a couple of tracks will turn into collabs, a couple of ones we're planning to release on our own. That's it, yeah. Just like slowly evolving the sound and evolving. You know, it's amazing like what PS1 did, you know? I remember him a year ago being like, yo, I'm going to focus a lot more on music. I just rented a studio. You know, he rented a studio. He started, you know, put his head down, grinded, and now he's got one of the biggest dance songs in the world.
Yeah.
And at least once a week, he texts me. He's like, yeah, you can do it too. He's like, what are you doing right now? You Chick-fil-A? Stop fucking around. Get back on the computer. You know, it's really motivating to see, you know, to see someone like Pete be like, yo, I'm going to do it. Put his head down, make music he actually likes, and turn it into that.
He's been in the game for a long time too. And it's like, for him to be able to hit on a big record at this point in his career should give anybody hope and the drive to be able to do it themselves, right? You just got to put the time and energy into it and make it a goal and make it focus of your time.
Yeah. The age thing, I don't think really applies, because if you if you go on just Google and then like Wikipedia, like any of the big like Diplo, Geta, look how old they are and look how old they were when they like hit a dope residency or a hit record. There's plenty of time for anybody, you know. It's I don't think there's like a certain stage in your career where you have to, you know, it's like, all right, didn't get that song. You know.
In production, that's definitely true. In the DJ world, I feel like, you know, you can't be the old man in the booth.
Well,
right?
So I have a weird
unless you're a house DJ and you're dancing. there's a weird
thing. I've had talks with like some younger kids about this. Me and Nikki Riz joke about this all the time. And it's like, you can only be so old and be like, you know, at like One Oak on a Sunday morning and playing the baby. You can only like after a certain age, it's kind of like, but then look at Solomon. The dude looks like he's like 98 years old. I watched him play for 14,000 people in Brooklyn like last year, you know? So it's like,
somehow you get a pass. You get a pass as a house DJ. Somehow, I don't know how it happens.
It's like house DJs are like wine. They're like, as they age, they get better and better and better. And like hip hop DJs, it's a weird thing. Like, that's why I've been focusing more and more on house. Not only do I like it, but it's like, I was like, okay. I was talking to a younger DJ about this and I was like, take the 10 best hip hop DJs alive or dead, put them on a flyer. Say they're going to be at Marquee. How many people do you think will show up? The 10 best hip hop DJs alive or dead. right? Like, I obviously AM, Crook and Clan, you know,
Jazzy Jeff,
Vice, you know, like whoever you think are like the top 10 DJs, put them on a flyer. Is it going to be a line down the block? Will I need promoters to help fill the seats?
Yeah, like they're selling way less tickets than the top 10 house guys.
How long will the party last for? 11 to 3-ish, and then it'll start dying out? Right. How many different songs will you actually hear? With the top 10 greatest hip-hop DJs ever. Now, take Solomon. That they'd send out an email blast, an underground flyer, and I've, with my own eyes, saw like 10,000 people, and that party lasted for like 12 hours. And that's one dude on a flyer in a warehouse. And he's not even in the top, he's not even in the top 10 of house DJs.
There's just a timelessness with house music, right? I mean, I pull up Getta tracks from 04 that like hit hard still. And like, they sound like they were produced last week. And you're just like, and like for every 20-year-old that's never heard it, it could be brand new to them. And it is brand new to them. But you play a hip hop track from that same era and it sounds like that era because everything is so commercialized, right? So I think that maybe we see something in like 5 years where, you know, it sounds like house music 2012 because that was such a boom, or 2011. Because that was such a boom, but I don't think we're there
yet. I was gonna say, it's funny, one of my favorite like tracks I was playing all summer, like this summer, like the pool parties and stuff, was Just a Little More Love, David Guetta, like the throwback.
Great record.
One of my favorites.
Huge summer track.
But what were you gonna say?
No, I was just gonna say, like, the great thing, what I love about house music and playing house music and making house music is you can take the original song and there could be 10 versions that you can play that fit into a different set.
Yeah.
And it's really hard to do that when you're playing open format, or especially hip hop, because there's 10 or 20 records that everybody wants to hear. And how can you really play that record a different way other than the way that you technically bring it in or out?
Right.
And like, that's what's just more interesting to me about playing and making house. Because I could take a disco house track and turn it into a bass house banger, or like, it's just cool to me. I could play the same record for 2 months and play 5 different versions. So the crowd is still interested. It's more interesting to me.
It is. There's even though to a lot of people, it's just like, oh, it's like, there's actually like so many, like you said, like so much diversity. You can play every night of the week and play a completely different set. And rock it. I'm not knocking hip hop, and I'm not knocking performance because I'm an old
DJ. Hip-hop. And
I've been on like a house wave kick lately, but I still love, you know, I still love open format. I still love hip hop. I still love playing it, and I think there's a time and place for that, 100%. So I'm not trying to sit on that, but you know, it's just, I don't know. I've been on a house kick lately, especially with the production and stuff like that.
I said to Gary, in a perfect world, like if I played, let's say 3 or 4 gigs in a weekend, like I would have open format, like deep house, open format, and then like big room. And that would be like a fun weekend for me.
Yeah. Well, that's, it's funny you say that. Cause that was always my mentality with my bookings. And we always tried to work, especially in the last couple of years, because I was fortunate to work so many nights a week. My motto with 4 a.m. like approaching my month and my calendar like that was to have it like, I would call it a diverse stock portfolio. Like, whereas each night was a little bit different type of music, so that if you heard me on a Wednesday and you heard me on a Friday, you weren't hearing the same thing. And it wasn't just bottle popping club. It was like, you know, one Jersey spot, one travel gig, one high end place, one dive bar kind of place, so that if one thing kind of fell off, there's still all these other legs and all these other things that were fun and interesting and had their own unique crowds and stuff like that. Like Wednesday, I would play, you know, my oldies, my feel good sets at Catch, which I still love doing, like playing like, you know, CCR and like, you know, like all this like random stuff into like sets. Then Thursdays would be my Lower East Side dive bar, Stacy's Mom into, you know, Montel Jordan kind of stuff. Friday would be, you know, the typical open format, you know, like Bridge and Tunnel, Fist Up in the Air stuff. Saturday would be a travel gig, and Sunday would be my brunch and One Oak late night, like hip hop super trap rap caviar set. Like, if you came out every night that week, you'd hear a completely different experience in a completely different style of crowd, but it would all be me and kind of make sense in a way.
I feel like there's not a ton of DJs that can do that though. Like maybe a handful. I don't know. Maybe I don't know enough DJs. I don't know. Is that my fault? But you know, a lot of DJs do pigeonhole themselves, I feel. And you know, there isn't enough versatility in their sets where you can get creative. I feel like for me, you can get creative anywhere.
100%.
You know, if it's a bottle popping, you know, if it's a bottle popping club, you could still, I'm not saying for a long period of time, but you could still hit a 10 minutes of like a bar, your best bar bangers, you know, just to shock people. Like you know, and that for me is what makes an amazing versatile DJ. And I don't feel like I've gotten out and heard enough of those. I don't know why that is. You know, is it the glorification of big room DJ, you know, big room house DJs, or, you know, the glorification of hip hop DJs?
I think it also has to partly do with like just the culture surrounding how DJs are treated in open format rooms. Sometimes some DJs are scared because if they play, you know, a festival version of a Kendrick Lamar track versus the original, is the manager going to run up to the booth and be like, "What are you doing? This guy just spent $15,000. Why are you playing this stuff?
Yeah,
I'm not booking you again." I think a lot of DJs are nervous that, you know, there are so many DJs and there's such a specific playlist for the most part that DJs play in so many rooms, that instead of, you know, walking the line and trying new things and being a little bit edgier, you know, the safe road is like, you know,
you kind of have to earn that, right? You have to earn that leeway to be able to like a manager to let you go a couple tracks that maybe normally wouldn't get played.
Yeah.
Whereas a new DJ, you definitely can't do that because they're like, ears are open. They're ready to go pounce on the DJ to be like, what the fuck is this?
Well there's risk reward. And that's something that, like, there's a lot of like little sayings and like little things I talk to you about. And it's like risk reward. There's like, you can be safe and take the 100 songs, play it, you know, throw in a couple old stuff, do what you got to do, whether it's open format or house or whatever, and you're going to be good. You're going to get by. It's going to be a good night. You got to risk being terrible in order to be great, you know? Because you could play a song and it could be awesome or it could be terrible and fail. But you're never going to have that great night unless you're willing to risk like that, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
No, that's what I was telling people. Like, you can be good and safe, but if you want to be great, you got to risk being terrible. That's, I don't know.
I think being safe will get you brought back for the next gig. And then that next gig, you could take your risks.
I always try to push the envelope as far as I can within reason and within in the right setting and room, you know?
Right. Of course.
I always tried to do that myself. Just like that's what's kind of made like my live style. It's just a lot of shock value and a lot of like, I know that, but fuck just happened.
People will remember that. That's the stuff they'll wake up the next morning and be like, yo, remember when Rick played that whatever track? Like, that's what people remember.
Right. But at the same time, some people come up to me and be like, yo, what are you doing? You got to be willing to put up with that.
Yeah.
You know, I've had people come right up to my face.
There's always going to be that 10%. That 10%. Yeah,
I've had people come right up to my face and be like, yo, you do not know music. I'm like, I'm sorry you feel that way. That's all you can do. I used to keep a bag of Jolly Ranchers in the DJ booth. So when somebody would come up to me and say, can you play this song right now? Or da da da, I'd be like, no. But then I'd give them a piece of candy. Because they'd be like, what? You're not going to, oh, okay. And they'd walk away. It used to work all the time.
Man, I like that. I might steal that.
Yeah, that was my thing for a long. So the lighting guy I used to work with at PhD always had like snacks and shit because it was like a long shift for him because he would do the happy hour shift into the night shift. He'd always have like, I would walk in the dude, he'd be like, you want a protein bar? You want candy? I was like, what are you, 7-Eleven? Like, it was awesome. No, it was like the best way possible. And then he used to give me Jolly Ranchers and I used to keep a couple like by the turntable. And one day this girl came to the booth, can you play, you know, like the typical play this thing?
Yeah.
And I was like, no. She's like, no, but no. I was like, listen, here, take this. I was like, let's make you feel better. And it actually worked. And I was like, holy shit. was like, that worked. So I tried it again the next time. And then I eventually, for a while, I just buy like a bag of Jolly Ranchers on my way to work and just be like, here. Yeah.
That's hilarious, man. So we've been talking a lot like music and nightlife stuff. I want to talk a little bit about your love for bourbon and kind of where it came from. Cause we see you posting about it. I'm like, man, this guy's really into bourbon. Like I never even seen half these bourbons. What are they? And Gary's a big bourbon guy. So
yeah, my golf buddy is actually a bourbon collector as well. So that's
the collection okay. So far.
Man, yeah. You got a favorite right now? Like what's the number one right now?
It would be this guy. This one. It's not anything fancy. I have some like rare bottles and stuff that like was given to me that, you know, the resale on it's crazy or it's exclusive. This Four Roses single barrel.
Yeah. That's like, what, 40, 45 bucks a bottle.
It's not so bad. It's not even like their really high end one or like their crazy one. Actually, I did just get a bottle of blends. That's awesome. And that was hard. Blends, yeah, that was hard for me to find. I found it at some like random liquor store in like the hood in Long Island by my parents' house. And it was like for like super cheap. Usually like it's like you only find it for resale. It's like, you know, bourbon's like supreme. Like there's like a resale and shit. It's crazy. But I found it for like $80, which is like super cheap for a bottle of blends. But my go-to on like the regulars is Four Roses a single barrel, I think. And Angel's Envy. Angel's Envy is a really good one too.
Angel's Envy's killer. Basil Hayden. Basil Hayden's another Basil go-to Hayden. in that realm.
And now like slowly I've been migrating into like maybe the scotches too, which I never thought I'd be like a scotch person, okay. But I got like the basic Macallan and a Glenlivet or Glenfiddich, one of them. And
I've been sipping on Evan Williams here. It's a nice inexpensive 100 nice. Proof. Evan Williams 100 proof.
Now I you're mean, a real listen, Southerner guy.
That's what happens.
Like some straight
down
up like
here,
South shit.
It is. My buddy who collects, like he's like, you gotta just go grab Evan Williams. He's like, the taste is real good. So I had grabbed like the $12 bottle, which sounds ridiculously cheap. And I was like, all right, it's a little thin. And then I went and grabbed their 100 proof and it was excellent. So if you can grab Evan Williams 100 proof up there, I don't know if they have it up there, but check it out. It's super. I got a handle.
I think I've seen it. And now you said it's good. I'll definitely add it and try it and stuff. You know,
try it out. Listen, it's no Basil Hayden.
Listen, I just like bourbons in general. It's like, not even like a get fucked up kind of way. It's like, you know, you come home at the end of the night. Like sometimes I won't drink the entire night and just come home. You know, pour a nice, like make an old fashioned or whatever, and just sit back, watch some TV and just relax. Like, I don't know. I've been really getting into it lately.
You got to follow my buddy, Birdies and Bourbon. He's good. On Instagram.
And you got to follow Dan the Bourbon Man. I learned a lot from that dude. Birdies.
Okay. Birdies and Bourbon. It's my golf buddy and we golf and he takes a bottle out and takes a picture at like the dopest hole.
Yeah.
With the visor.
Sick. Yeah. When my boy was opening that place, I was like the guinea pig with the mixologist, tried all these different drinks and they're like weird spin on an old fashioned, really got me into bourbon. And then the mixologist who was programming his menu had this like ridiculous speakeasy style place in Williamsburg that I used to go to on my way to Brooklyn Mirage. We'd stop there first and, you know, pregame before Mirage. And every time he'd like, it wasn't just go there and get a drink. He'd be like, what do you want? I'm like, you tell me. And he would just,
You're the professional.
He would give us his history lesson and we try like, I've had stuff that like literally the bottle is this big, but it's like a few $100 and it's illegal in America. And it was smuggled in like a Timberland shoe, like the weirdest stuff ever. But he used to teach me all these things and like all these different styles. And then, a couple of the managers at a couple of the venues, like one of like the restaurant managers at Catch, huge whiskey collector. He has like 400 bottles. So he would always like run up into the booth while I was DJing and be like, yo, you got to try this. I'm like, what is it? He goes, shut up. You drink it neat. This is what it is. But he got me into Michter's and like Cesar, like all these like random brands. And slowly, like over the last year or so, it's just been like a little, like it's a hobby. Like I used to collect Supreme and I was into Kith and then I was into Yeezys and now it's, I don't know, I like bourbons. I don't know. And my brother and I really like it. I'm really close to my little brother. So that was like, we would always go to Brooklyn Mirage together. It's like an escape from like, that was like our, little mental vacation. It's like, you know, go to Brooklyn Mirage, listen to some awesome music. And I used to like, you know, just learn from all these big DJs. So we'd always stop first, get taught by this wizard of bourbon, like about different stuff. And it became like this little tradition last summer. And then at the beginning of quarantine, I think I bought like one of those big, like 1.7 liter of Bullet. And that lasted a little bit. And I was like, all right, well, if this quarantine is going to continue, let's expand the palate a little bit. And like 2 months into quarantine, my parents live in Long Island. There's a huge Total Wine. And once I found out about Total Wine and how cheap everything is there, I was like with a shopping cart. I was like, all right, I gotta try this. And mm-hmm. now there's a collection.
Nah, that's dope. And it's good that we all need like other stuff outside of music that we can be creative and do, you know, something to get us away from music and kind of let us rest the brain, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So I just want to end with a couple quick hitters.
Sure.
So you had mentioned like going to Brooklyn Mirage as like an escape and listen to DJs. So like when you're unfocused or overwhelmed, is there anything that you do to cope with that?
Either classic rock or watch an episode of Entourage and remind myself that I want to be like Vinny Chase. Because they're so short. It's like 25 minute episodes. Gets me like that's how a fucking like a rock star on top should act like, or a movie star, whatever it is. Like, yo, get your shit together, get motivated, let's go.
Nah, I like that. I love Entourage.
Yeah.
What is an unusual habit or weird thing that you love?
Unusual habit or weird thing that I love?
I know, I'm putting you on the spot on these.
I'm really into like candles and meditation. As weird as that sounds.
Man, I wish I knew more about your meditation. I would have grilled you about that because I like it too.
I was using Headspace for a while, and now I use this app called Inscape. I really like those.
I've been using Calm.
Okay, yeah, that's a good one too.
So same thing.
Inscape, there's an actual like physical location right next to Bounce on 21st Street that sells like CBD and all stuff. So I used to, I just started using their app because I wanted to support like a local company kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And last one is, what advice would you give a DJ that's looking to either take the next step or break into the DJ industry right now?
Don't waste this time. Like, really focus in on what kind of DJ you want to be and take this time right now to do as much networking and brand growth and skill building as you can. Just because you can't play clubs doesn't mean you can't be super creative and go viral on Twitch and create a party out of nothing right now, so that when clubs open back up, they want to hire you because you're so like popping on Twitch and you have such a great online presence. You can create content anywhere. And I'm sure you guys know this because you guys create a ton of content. You don't have to be in a club with a photographer taking pictures of you in a DJ booth to transform your Instagram and, you know, Instagram and whether it's TikTok or whatever it is. Just be creative as possible. Focus on your brand as much as possible. And don't forget that like music is most important, you know, like practice, you know, practice. Love in front of people, practice on the live stream, just practice. Yeah.
Perfect. No, I think that's a great way to wrap up too. What do you want to plug? I mean, talk about your graphic design business. Talk about whatever you want to talk about.
Oh, Pixel Plug.
Yeah,
that's my other baby. My graphic design thing. You know, just doing a lot of flyers for everybody. When it's all, I did like all the flyers being in quarantine for D-Nice. I did all them. Just separate little side business I've been doing. There's nothing really to plug right now. The music's coming out in like 2 months, so I got nothing right now. I'm just going through it. I can't promote any parties, man, because they don't want to be promoted them.
Yeah, we were talking about like the no phone secret parties that are happening on Saturday this weekend.
The music's coming out in 2 months, and the parties can't be promoted. So,
all right. So where can people follow you?
Instagram.
Instagram at Pixel Plug Media. Is that what it is?
Pixel Plug Media. Yeah.
Pixel Plug Media at Rick Wonder.
Yeah. Guys, thank you so much for having me on, man.
Dope.
Nah, thanks for rocking on. I mean, a lot of awesome gems in this conversation. So we appreciate you, man. Absolutely. Keep doing what you do too.
Appreciate it, guys. Thanks,
man.
All right, man.